Okay, hello everybody. My name is Ana Clara Rodrigo. I'm a clinical psychologist, IFS and EMDR certified therapist, and run a clinic called Acerca de Psicoterapia here in Madrid, in Argüelles. And I'm here today to begin a series of IFS masterclasses with translation for all the Spanish community. And it's my pleasure today to introduce Derek Scott. Derek is a certified IFS therapist, psychologist, and social worker with more than 35 years of experience in the field of therapy and counseling. He has worked as an IFS therapist for the last 15 years and has been dedicated to raising awareness of the model in Canada through his organization, IFSCA, his retreat center, and through the lectures he gives all around the world. He has been dedicated to grief for 18 years as an AIDS counselor, specializing in multiple loss. And he's the author of several publications like Self-Led Grieving, Transitions, Loss and Death that you can find in this book. And Healing Through Internal Compassion, Grief and the Internal Family Systems, among others, included in relevant books of IFS and psychology. Hi, Derek, how are you?
I'm well, thank you, Ana Clara.
Derek, I'm so happy to have you here and have the opportunity to enjoy a webinar with you very soon on loss and grief. You don't really know me, but I have been meeting with you almost every night while walking my dog, listening to countless explanations on IFS. And I really want to thank you for being one of the few people spreading IFS on the web from the beginning. When I was looking for some information on the web, you were there and the only person there. So thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So Derek, I know you were a Gestalt therapist before. How did you get to know IFS therapy?
I had a client who was seeking a Gestalt therapist. I was working with him and he came in one day and he said, "Have you seen this book?" And I said, "No." He said, "It's by this guy called Richard Schwartz." So I read it, I thought, interesting. I might try some of this. So I had a client and I tried IFS. By the end of the session, he had 15 parts in different rooms in a hotel. I didn't know why. He didn't know why. I thought, there's more to this. So I went down to Mexico to a retreat with Dick Schwartz and Bob Cargill for a week. And we were immersed in the model. And I started off, my skeptical part was up. It's like, who is this guy? Yeah, okay. He's got lots of women that love him. Yeah.
I know
that. And by Wednesday, So by Wednesday, I was like, okay, he's onto something. He's sincere. And I had some shifts in my own system. And at the time I was fighting with my co-parent, we raise a child together. And I got the clarity that my part that was fighting with her was connected to a part of me that was frightened of her anger. And that her anger was coming at me because a part of her was frightened by me. So once I got that clarity, I was able to come home, meet with her, have a conversation, and reconnect. So both personally and professionally, I've been working with it ever since. Yeah.
Great. And how has the IFS model changed the way you do therapy?
A number of ways. I'm very clear that what my job is now. My job is to hold self energy by keeping my parts back, to invite the client to get curious about their parts so that their self can heal their own system. That's it. I do not need to give them resources. I do not need to make interventions. I don't need to give them advice. I don't need to worry about them. I don't need to take responsibility for them. They are responsible for their own healing. My job is to guide them into that healing. And it is such a relief and a joy. You know, at the end of the session, it's like, that was great.
So. Yeah, it is. It is. IFS is fantastic for this. No, you don't need to be the perfect psychologist, the perfect I don't know, somebody else more important than you, no? I am here just to accompany you. Okay. And Derek, have you been working on grief and loss sometime before being an IFS therapist. So could you explain what novelties IFS can bring to other models?
Sure. Yeah. Well, I unexpectedly started working with grief and loss in my 20s. AIDS hit my community. So I became an AIDS counselor in the 1980s when I was 25, I think. And it was very difficult because there were so many deaths at the time. So I quickly learned about grief personally and professionally. And then when I discovered IFS, I was able to adapt the teachings to an understanding of multiplicity. So for example, in the bereavement field, there were discussions. Grief is about an existential crisis. Grief is about the family of origin. Grief is about learning new skills. Grief is about tasks. When we understand that there's many parts in the system, all of that is true. It depends which part you're asking. So there is no definitive way to grieve. There's an understanding of the complexity of grief and the number of parts that are involved. But what's very clear is that what's been learned in childhood about significant loss results in parts being exiled, possibly, and protectors. Because many children, the parents, the family, don't understand that children grieve, and they don't understand what a significant loss is. So if I say to someone, an adult, what losses did you have in childhood? They'll often say, oh, none, because nobody died. But if they moved classes and they lost a beloved teacher, if they moved homes and they lost their environment, if their friendship groups suddenly pushed them away and they were no longer willing to be friends, those are significant losses. Hmm. And they bring up an emotional response. If that's not supported by the adults, then the system has to figure out what to do, which is where the minimizing part comes in. It's not that bad. Or messages about you're a baby if you cry, or boys don't cry, or nobody wants to see your tears, or however they get responded to, you're being silly. Those messages get taken on by the protectors. And then in adult circumstances, when there's a loss, the same parts will come up. I'm being silly. It's not that big a deal. I shouldn't cry. Because the protectors get fearful of going into the parts holding the big feelings because they're concerned about being overwhelmed. So one of the gifts of the IFS work is we come into the protectors. We say, do you know what year it is? Do you know how old I am? Can you feel my love for you? And if you can, would you let me connect to that little boy who's so sad because he lost his teacher? Would that be okay? And then once the sad part is heard, witnessed, if it's burdened, releasing the burden, the protectors can relax. And to be honest, Anna Clara, as I get older, I know how to listen to my grieving parts, and I'm really glad because I cannot see as well as I used to. I cannot hear as well as I used to. I cannot run as fast as I used to. So as we age, our sense of our identity and what happens in our body changes. And that's a loss. And if we know how to attend to the loss, the parts holding the loss, then we don't get stuck in one. We don't become the old person who's saying, oh, it was better years ago. That's a part. And we can listen to that part, but we don't need to be that part. So I consider listening into the parts that hold grief and loss as a life skill, a very valuable life skill.
Yeah. You are right. And as you mentioned before, it's true. Many, many times the family don't consider other losses that the kids has are outside the family. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's really important. Yeah. And many times also because they consider they are maybe too small and they don't notice and they will adapt very soon and they don't take care of of kids in this respect. Okay, thank you. What else? In a society so centered on happiness, grief is looked at negatively, almost like a weakness. Can you comment on that?
Yes, it's one of the things that makes getting support for your grief difficult. Here in North America, if you have a significant loss, if your parent dies or your child, you get 3 days of bereavement leave. Then you're expected to go back to work. And there are myths, you know, people expect you to be over it in 6 months. Right? So in 6 months, if you're still talking about your mother, really? You know, so we do live in a don't worry, be happy culture. And the more full aspects of being human, just being human. We attach, we lose, we grieve. We attach, we lose, we grieve. But if they're not culturally supported, then again, you know, we either have to go to therapy or we keep it locked in. And when those feelings are locked in, they go into the musculature, they go into the body, they go into the soma, neck and shoulder pain, very common, gastrointestinal distress, migraines. These can all be parts trying to get our attention. Hello, I'm hurting, I'm crying, but with nowhere to go.
Yeah. I'm not sure about here in Spain, but I think it's 1 to 3 days to grieve. So it's similar. So it's nothing.
It's nothing. And those 3 days, you're still in shock. You're not even grieving. You're in shock. You're organizing the funeral. You're letting people know. And your protectors are keeping you in shock. I'm okay. You know?
Yeah. I passed through this not too long ago, and I know what you're talking about. So could you mention some of the protectors involved in loss?
Yes, I named some of them earlier, but the very common ones are, shock. So disbelief, this isn't happening, this cannot be happening, this isn't real. That gives the parts here time to get used to what just happened. Right? If you've ever lost your purse or your wallet or your keys, you'll know that. The first thing that comes, I can't have lost my keys. They have to be here somewhere. And then you look in the oven.
What about the mobile? If you lose your mobile, everybody is like, oh my God, where's my mobile?
I can't have lost it. Because there will be big consequences. So same internally, shock, disbelief, numbing, just I'm feeling nothing. And that I'm feeling nothing. Maybe I didn't really love them, you know. But no, that's a protector, numbing. Minimizing, we weren't that connected. It was only a dog. It was only a miscarriage. Postponing, I'll grieve later when I have time. So those are the first ones that tend to come up, is the denial, the disbelief, the shock, the minimizing, right? Trying to keep it down.
Oh, thank you. And talking about numbing and lack of emotional connection, I think this is a real challenge in the sessions. So how do you handle it?
Well, in the bereavement literature, they used to talk about delayed grief because it's quite common that grief will not be present right away. With the IFS understanding, it's a numbing protector. It's a numbing protector that's coming in. So two things, we want to get to know that protector. Do you know I'm here? Thank you so much for numbing this out so that I don't have to feel it all at once. Would it be okay to get to know the parts that you're numbing, the parts that are holding the feelings? And it will say yes or no. If I have a lot of self energy and it's still saying no, then I would say, what's the concern? Because with grief, there is a timetable in the system. And sometimes the part will say, we're not ready. We're just not ready. And I don't know if you've noticed this, Anna Clara, but after a significant loss, you get the initial information. And a little while later, some other parts hear the news. Not every part hears it at once. So I'll give you an example. My beloved dog, George, died 2.5 years ago. And he was my pal. 3 months after he had died, I was driving home. One day I took a different turn and I saw some hills. And this part came up and said, "Oh, George would love those hills. We should take him there to play." And then the moment that came, I let that part know George's past, and I had to pull over because I was just sobbing and sobbing and sobbing. But this little part of me somehow didn't have the information yet, you know?
Yeah.
So it takes a while. There's a timing of how grief moves through the system like a wave.
Thank you for your example and to share it. Yeah. Okay. So there are different, talking now in general about IFS, there are different approaches saying that this kind of therapies like EMDR or IFS can traumatize people again or re-traumatize by making them remember the past. What would you respond to them?
Well, it seems to be based on a false understanding of the system because it's not about remembering the past. Right? The parts I'm talking about sit in the psyche. They're frozen in time, but they're available in the present moment and they are trying to get our attention. So if a little part that's upset is trying to get our attention, we need to bring our attention to it. It's already in the distress. We don't re-traumatize it. It's sitting there. There might be a six-year-old girl saying, my grandmother died and they did not let me go to the funeral and nobody's talking to me about it. And mommy and daddy are not talking to me at all. Maybe I killed her because I wish she was dead at Christmas, something like that. That six-year-old has never been able to tell that story. So it's stuck holding that story and holding the worry that it's responsible for its grandmother's death because children have magical thinking. And until we attend to it, every time there's a loss, that adult is going to feel guilty, vaguely guilty. Maybe it's my fault. They won't know why, but it's that little one trying to get the attention each time.
Yeah. And also for me, the difference is that when you go to see the child or the exile, you are going with yourself. So the child is not alone. So it's not possible to re-traumatize because you are with him. He's not alone anymore.
That's right. No? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe.
Yeah. Okay. So can you explain us a little more about what will you offer in the upcoming workshop on grief and loss?
I think the most helpful thing for an IFS therapist or practitioner is to know your own loss story. Because what will happen is when my dog George had passed, I have to go to work. If that week somebody had come in and they had had a loss, maybe their brother had got killed or something, my parts would get triggered. Now, if I know how to attend to them, so it would be, oh, I know you're thinking of George. I know how sad you are. I'm going to spend some time with you afterwards. Then I could say to the client, tell me more about your brother. What happened? Or which parts of you are connected to the loss of your brother. But if I don't know how to do that, my protectors will say, we're getting upset, change the subject. You know, how's your mum dealing with the loss, right? Just talk about something different because I'm triggered. So if we know our own losses and if we know how to attend to them internally, then we're able to serve our clients better and our parts. So there'll be an invitation to know your own loss story. What losses as a child did you experience and what happened and what did you learn? There'll be an opportunity to become aware of how grief gets held in the body, which parts are holding grief in different parts of your body. There'll be an understanding of the differences between what's called simple loss and complex bereavement and the protectors that come up in complex bereavement. So people will know what to look out for and which questions to ask. As you know, in IFS, we bring our curiosity to the work, but that in curiosity is informed by an understanding. So here's an example. If somebody has lost a loved one, what's very, very common is that they will experience them in some way. They will hear their voice. They'll dream of them. they'll sense their presence or some other way that they'll experience a communication. But they may also think they're crazy and that they couldn't tell their therapist that because the therapist will think they're crazy. So if we know that, we can just ask. Oh, your mom passed 8 months ago. Have you been experiencing her in any way? And it opens the door to be able to speak to that truth. And if not, it doesn't matter. But if they have, we then give permission to be able to name that experience. Yeah. So what I'll be offering is both the theory around grief and bereavement and how that relates to IFS, how that relates to you as a therapist, and then how that can inform your practice.
Okay, so thanks again, Derek. It was a pleasure to have you here. Mm-hmm. And we remind you that you will have the opportunity to learn more from Derek next February 5th from 2 till 9. And it will be a 7 hours webinar on grief and loss through IFS lens. Thank you, Derek. Thank you, everybody.
You're welcome, Anna Clara. Happy New Year to you.
And Happy New Year and Happy Christmas. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.